Thanks, Dan. The reason I actually first came to SFI was not extinction, not the collapse. It was actually because I wanted to figure out how to look at recovery, what happens afterwards. I actually was delusional enough 25 years ago or so to think that we knew something about the extinction that we needed to figure out what happened afterwards. And we spent the last 25 years figuring out more and more about the extinction. So my assigned title is The Collapse of Ecosystems. I'm going to talk about this initially sort of standing back and then zeroing in on this event halfway through this diagram here, the end-Permian mass extinction 251 million years ago. Oh, it doesn't work too well. Which is the biggest divot that you see in that graph there. This is a graph of the diversity of fossilized marine organisms through the last 600 million years. It was initially compiled by Jack Sepkoski, who was one of the early participants in SFI a long time ago, by collecting records of the first and last occurrences of, in this case, genera, so groups of species, through the fossil record of the last 600 million years. And you can see lots of divots in here, and today is up here, and the Cambrian explosion is back here on the left side of the diagram. And Jack and Dave Raup worked for many years on the sort of five canonical big extinctions, which are the largest divots that you see in here. The one that you've all probably heard the most about is the last one here at the end of the Cretaceous, which includes the disappearance of the dinosaurs and other sort of non-essential parts of the biota. But the interesting events are actually back here in the Paleozoic, and the one I'll talk about most is this big divot here at the end of the Permian. Mass extinctions and biotic crises are actually just a part of life. They're nothing to be afraid of. They happen all the time. That's just the way the world works. This is a graph a little bit different, also based on Jack's data, showing the proportion of generic extinctions, which you can see there's sort of an overall decline through the last 600 million years. But the major point is that there are lots of these events. In fact, the expectation is that bad stuff happens and things die. And then at some point, things get better. This is a similar plot with a more comprehensive data set. And you'll see that there's a lot more volatility in the data. And this has led to a two-decade-long argument by many of my colleagues about exactly what sort of statistical treatments you should apply to the data to see what the diversity is, none of which I have taken part of. And the reason for that is that it sort of doesn't matter how you look at the data statistically at the end of the Permian because everything died. And you don't need a lot of statistics to figure that out. Which is good because I'm really lousy at statistics. And a paper that was published in PNAS in December, a group of people largely based at Harvard took a network approach to looking at this newer data set called the Paleobiology Database, and they looked at basically the swings in ecological modules. So this was an attempt to look at the ecological structures and how they were affected during these events. And the peaks in this diagram, without going too much into the data, again, we're going from 600 million years ago up to today, you can see that there are a couple of very large increases in different analyses of the network structure. This suggests that the Ordovician biodiversification event is one of the largest swings in diversity, along with the Ordovician mass extinction and then this Permo-Triassic mass extinction 250 million years ago. So the short form of this talk, really short form of a 20-minute talk, is bad things happen fast, things get better slowly, and new things happen. And the thing that I want to come back to at the end is the issue of when new things happen. Because the assumption has been for decades and decades that new things happen as a result of things getting better. And I want to suggest that we have at least some data that the new things are actually happening before or during the bad things, which might seem a little counterintuitive, but that's the way the world works. The end-permanent mass extinction 251 million years ago is the reason you have clams and lobster and sea urchins and things like that in the oceans today, because the consequence of this event was the disappearance of trilobites and bryozoans and brachiopods, most of which you may have never heard of. They dominated 400 million years of life in the oceans. They disappeared during this event, and they were replaced eventually by a different suite of organisms. But we went through this interval of time when we went from diverse ecosystems, like the sorts of things we could see in West Texas if we went on a field trip down past Carlsbad, to ecosystems that were dominated by microbes and the few things that actually survived this event. And with my colleagues at Nanjing, I've been working since the mid-90s on projects trying to understand this event. This is the Permo-Triassic boundary. They've built a park with this interesting shrine. The boundary itself is up here that we spent quite a lot of time studying. And if you collect data from those sections and then plot them on a stratigraphic column here, so time is now going up this axis, these are the duration of 330 species. And you can see that there's they pretty abruptly disappear. Now, it turns out there actually is a reason for using statistics to figure out how fast this disappearance was, and we did all that. And everything collapsed, which we pretty much already knew. So then we looked at a series of additional sections across China. And this is through the last part of the Carboniferous, the Permian period here, and then everything collapses. And by everything, this is the disappearance of about half the families, 84% or so of the genera, and we think about 95% of all species. So this is as close of marine invertebrates that are fossilized. I can't tell you how much disappeared that doesn't show up in the fossil record. We also know that it's the only mass extinction that insects ever suffered. There's a good loss of vertebrates and plants on land as well, although not as severe as what we see in the marine record. The problem with these sections is that although we can get pretty good estimates on what's happening from Meishan and these other sections, time is compressed. And with my colleague Sam Bowring in his lab at MIT, we began looking at how fast this happened. And our initial estimate was that it took a million years. And then we went back and got the ash beds, which are what Sam dates. These volcanic ash beds have zircons in them that Sam's lab can date very precisely. And then we got the extinction down to 100,000 years. And then in 2014, we got it down to 60,000 years. And then last year, by going to a new section that I'll show you in a minute, we can show that this extinction, at least in well-preserved sections, happened in less than 31,000 years. And this is for an event 251 million years in the past. So that's a pretty high degree of temporal resolution, although in some ways, as I'll mention at the end, it really isn't high enough yet. Now, I've said everything went extinct. That's actually not completely accurate. There is a differential pattern of selectivity that paleontologists have been trying to pull apart for 20 years or so. This is data, again, from an analysis that we published in 2014, looking at a variety of different groups from things that live on top of the sediment over here at number one to things that are burrowing down in the sediment. These are all bivalves, and you can see that there is a different pattern of extinction and recovery depending upon the ecology of some of these different mollusks. The same is true of a lot of other bivalves. The difficulty we have is inferring exactly what the pattern of selectivity means, because there are different ways of identifying what the causative agent is, and given the magnitude of the extinction, it's hard to really say what is going extinct, or we know what's going extinct, we don't know exactly what the reason is. And one of the problems that we have, the biggest difficulty with it as paleontologists is actually seeing inside the extinction. We see who's there before the extinction, we see what the survivors are. It's very difficult to understand the internal dynamics of the process. Most assumptions have been that extinctions happen by the loss of primary productivity, which is what I show on the left here with the orange dots, and then they percolate up through the network. It's of course possible that, particularly with the cause of these events, that actually lots of different taxa nodes within the network are disappearing as a result of the primary extinction. Thus far, we don't have the resolution to be able to distinguish between the primary extinctions that are due to whatever the cause is, and then the secondary effects of the collapse of the ecological network, which is what we'd really like to get to. So to do that, we started working, actually 25 years ago, at a place called Panglintan, where we actually got to have wonderful discussions with the local policemen about the extent of corruption in the town, which was not dissimilar from what we just heard about. They found, after the mayor died in bed with his mistress, they found lots of gold bars under his bed. It helps to get away from the security police when you're talking to the county officials. This is a section along the Hongshui River in Panglintan that we've been extensively collecting with the colleagues in Nanjing. It's 10 times as thick for the same amount of age as the section Meishan that we've done most of the work in. So we have 10 times the record in this section that we have in a lot of the other sections. So what we hoped was that by combining paleontology and chemostratigraphy and this high-resolution geochronology, we'd actually be able to pull this event apart at this locality. I won't go through this diagram. This is the Meishan section here on the left, the first one that we studied that most people look at. This is the much more expanded section on the right. And the main point I want to make here is that as good as our age resolution gets, and as thick as the section we get, as thick as the section is that we can study, the extinction happened more rapidly. So we can resolve time down to 30,000 years for this event, and the extinction happened more rapidly than that. I don't know if it happened on Tuesday afternoon. I don't know how long it took, but it took less than 31,000 years. Now, the causes of this are not really a main point. I just want to say that people have suggested everything from drifting continents to dark matter. That was actually published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, believe it or not. Cosmic radiation was really big in the 50s for obvious reasons. But the leading cause of this event is probably the massive eruptions of volcanism in Siberia. This is about a 5 kilometer thick section of what's called the Siberian flood basalts. And a particular phase of this massive eruption, which is about the size of the continental United States, the whole thing erupted in a million years. A particular phase of it seems to have erupted right at the boundary. So lots of bad things happened. The question is, what's the dynamic of that process? and how does that dynamic of the extinction influence what happens afterwards? Now, the quote-unquote recovery, which is a misnomer, takes a minimum of 5 million years after this event. There are a lot of taxa that show up, new taxa that show up soon after the end of the extinction, but normally functioning ecosystems take about 5 million years. Partly that's because there are a series of other insults that are happening during that 5 million years. So it's not like, you know, this is the end of the bad stuff and then things get better. It's not unlike what Ricardo was describing in Venezuela. Even after Maduro, a lot of bad stuff is still going to be going on. It's not going to be happy days for her again on Tuesday morning. One suggestion for what is driving this extinction came from Jonathan Payne's group at Stanford in a paper they published last year in Science. They looked at an estimate of the latitudinal spread of extinctions, and they suggested that this massive volcanism led to a temperature increase, which our group and others had shown was in the neighborhood of 6 to 8 degrees centigrade associated with the extinction horizon, but that this was a differential pattern from the poles to the tropics, and that you actually can get some sense of this, the differential pattern of selectivity. Now, I've said this extinction is less than 30,000 years. That's actually true of every mass extinction event that we have good data for. They're all fast. I think that's an important clue to what's driving them. So for an event called the Hangenberg during the late Devonian, the extinction interval with fairly good quality data is on the order of 50,000 to 100,000 years. The KT boundary with the impact and possible volcanism is certainly less than 20,000 years for the extinction horizon. The end Triassic, a little bit after the end Permian event, has been estimated at an extinction interval of about 5,000 years, which is a phenomenal level of temporal resolution and probably a little bit more than the data actually supports. But nonetheless, all of these events are fast. At least fast by my standards, if not fast by many other people's. So how do we look at the process of recovery? What Jack Sapkowski did in 1984 was fit a couple logistic model to the global data. And he suggested that the sweep of Phanerozoic history could be explained by these coupled logistic models with three faunas, one of trilobites called the Cambrian, and then a Paleozoic fauna, which disappears largely at the Permo-Triassic, and then what we call the modern fauna. And then we just add some perturbations to these coupled logistics that kind of mimics the data. That led to a big debate among quantitatively unskilled, basically, paleontologists about whether they should use a logistic or an exponential, which was largely unedifying. Is this being recorded? Ricard Soleil and I in 2008-2009 tried some other models, very simplistic, but it was late at night, and that's what you do at Santa Fe. So we used linear and logistic and then hyperbolic models to try and see what they would do, and then separated out herbivores and predators to try and look at what the expected response would be if you look at different components of an ecosystem. The difficulty with these models is that they assume that life is going along, bad things happen, and then life gets better. And we now know that the pattern, we now suspect that the pattern is actually more complex in a very interesting way. So I've said new things happen. If you look immediately after the end Permian mass extinction, basically all the interesting vertebrate groups of the Mesozoic and Cenozoic show up right after the extinction. Mammals, dinosaurs, turtles, thylacosaurs, phytosaurs, plesiosaurs, and everything else. If you go up to the road to Ghost Ranch, Stuart Nesbitt and a bunch of other people have been collecting from sequences up there. They have some of the earliest turtles. The other the two earliest turtles are actually in China. All of these taxa are, as we get more and more data, all of them are showing up in the fossil record immediately within 5 million years after this end primitive event. So the dinosaurs went from being an upper Triassic phenomenon to a middle Triassic phenomenon to an early Triassic phenomenon. Same thing is true of mammals. Ichthyosaurs are great. They basically look like dolphins, which are mammals, except these are reptiles. All the major groups of ichthyosaurs show up immediately after this event. This is a phylogeny. Here, the time is along the top. This is a phylogeny along the bottom. And several of these major groups here all show up in one series of quarries in Anhui province in China. So they've already diversified by the time they show up in the fossil record. We look at terrestrial vertebrates. Same things going on. There's a paper about plants that came out in December in Science that showed four of the major groups of Mesozoic sea plants first occur in Permian sections before the extinction in Jordan. This is also true in some of the other events. This is a analysis of bird diversity from Jarvis and colleagues in Science in 2014. And the KT mass extinction horizon is closely associated with the diversification of lots of different bird groups. But there's some new data for groups that have living representatives today that shows that actually, if we look at molecular data from these living groups, the origin of the clades is in the Permian. It's before the extinction. So these new novelties of turtles or dinosaurs or mammals or whatever are not showing up as a consequence of after the extinction. They're arising before the extinction. And Rachel Wood and I have suggested that many of the novelties associated with them actually arise as a consequence of anoxia associated with these extinction events. And we published that about a year and a half ago. So what I think is going on is that the new clades are arising before the extinction. During the crisis, the nature of the environmental crises, in fact, may often contribute to the origin of morphological and developmental novelties, which then show up as new taxa after the extinction horizon in the early Triassic, for example. That after that occurs, we wind up with the increase in taxonomic diversification. So that's the picture that I think we're getting about the link between these extinction events and novelty. It's not actually, it's Schumpeterian, I hope, because I'm very fond of Schumpeter, but in a different way than Schumpeter would have recognized in the 1930s. That's the end.
Okay, Jeffrey. I was warned never to ask if Jeffrey has a question, but go ahead, Jeffrey. Can we get a microphone to you?
So you give us a global paleontological view of the interpretation of the title of the talk, The Collapse of Ecosystems. And wonderful phenomenology and wonderful summary of the sequence of events. But I missed the question of mechanism. That is, are there any principles that you can learn from this are related to what some of us often think of as ecosystems, like, you know, what's going on in the Sagra de Cristos here, and the big questions that are coming up in terms of climate change on the planet, in terms of global ecosystems on much shorter timescales. And as an extension of that, in terms of the principles and the dynamics mechanisms, in what way can it be quantitative, and how is it related to what Ricardo talked about, because his was also of a similar nature. Every case seemed particular. Like in Ricardo's case, Greece, Venezuela, the Soviet Union, there's always something special happened, as it is with this. But are there any general principles that somehow transcend the particularity of the multiple things you're talking about and the timescales that you were involved in? Now, maybe that's something, that's presumably a theme that goes through the day, but I wanted to bring it up at the beginning.
Wait, how long do I have to respond? So that was my point about peering inside these events. So we have not had the temporal resolution to do more than look at before and after. I think we're actually getting to the point where we will be able to look into the energy of these events. But my other point about time was that if all of these events are happening on similar timescales, I actually think there is there are generalities that we will be able to identify. I don't actually think that the cause matters. I'll let that sink in a minute. I don't think it matters whether it was impact or volcanism or whatever. I mean, that's what paleontologists have spent 30 years worrying about. I don't think it matters. I think the fact that the timescale is so similar in all these events, once these crises get to a certain point, my guess is that they may collapse in similar ways. And that's, I think, exactly where SFI comes in, because that's the issue for us is how that propagates through an ecological network, not what the actual cause, the triggering event is.
Well, Jeffrey, let's hold off on some of those broader questions because we're going to have a lot of time for that, and we will build through the day. Sean, you're next. Seth, go ahead.
Mentioned your preferred suspect was anoxia for
the. No, I think anoxia is one of the proximal consequences of.
Is this why in the Permian extinction that it seemed that the sea was more hard hit than the land?
Well, we have much higher resolution in the oceans than we do on land, so it's harder to have confidence in the estimates we have for plants or insects because we have, you know, marine data here, all the way up, and we have plants down here and plants up here. So it does look like the marine realm was hit somewhat harder, but the terrestrial realm was still hit well over half of the taxa of plants and vertebrates are going extinct. Now, when we get to the fine details of the causes, we think that a lot of the terrestrial extinction was due to acid rain and the direct effects of the volcanism rather than anoxia and high temperature and things like that. So the proximal causes probably differ as well.
So hold on. I see you, John. I see you, Dave. I just am looking to get a little diversity here and see if we get any other hands going up. Seeing none, John, go ahead.
Quick comment and then a question. So in the financial business, I think there is a kind of theory that debt is linked to many of these crises. I think the most surprising part of Ricardo's talk was that it wasn't just the corruption and the obliteration of the invisible hand, but debt suddenly appears in the middle and causes a lot of the problem. And at the end of these debt crises, there's often a new innovation, like CDS, which helps to cause the crisis. So my question was, in your case, you made this very fascinating remark that these new species use different words. I don't know the difference between them, clara and anyway, a bunch of different things. New things started appearing.
Yeah, genies and things like that.
Yeah, they started appearing just after the crisis and even just before the crisis. And I was wondering, why would they appear just before the crisis, and did they help precipitate the crisis?
No, I don't think they help precipitate the crisis because I think they're ecologically irrelevant. They're showing up, but at very low numbers and low abundance. So there's, if you think about this from a network standpoint, if you took those nodes out, it's unlikely to have any effect on the network pre-extinction. But I think they're arising through the usual process of the diversification of clades. The point that Rachel and I made is that they don't act, although the clades had originated, they haven't taken on the novel characters until the crisis itself. That's when, we think, that's when the environmental conditions lead to novelty formation that then gets solidified afterwards. So before the extinction, we may not have noticed that these were turtles because they weren't turtles. They were the clade that acquired turtledom, whatever, during and immediately after the crisis. So there's a careful distinction, but I don't think they're actually causing the crisis. Now, Stuart would disagree. So the first meeting I ever came to of SFI included the great debate between David Raup and Stuart Kaufman about mass extinctions in 1998 or 9, in which Stuart argued that these were all endogenous events rather than having some exogenous cause.
Which requires remarkable geological coincidence. David.
Yeah, so Doug, so I want to take us back to the big debate between, you know, chance and necessity and contingency and the Gouldian tape. So it's what you're saying, it seems to me, is the perturbation could be almost anything, yeah. But there is some regularity by virtue of the cascading failure over the network, right? But the outcome of that is opportunity, and the particular families or genera or genies, as John likes to say, that appear over time are unpredictable. So is there no prospect for a large-scale analysis of the evolution of complexity on the biosphere? Or is it really the regularities at a more microscopic level, but the particular sequence of megafauna or what have you are random?
That's why we're so interested in history, right? Because we don't, that's the question that we want to understand. The problem with looking at recoveries is that if I know the survivors of this event, it's almost impossible for me to predict, if I do the thought experiment, to predict who's going to be the winners in 5 million years or in 10 million years. It's not based on who did the best in, you know, which clade had the most species. My view is that there's a dynamic to the recovery process as these ecosystems are rebuilding through niche construction, the things that we've talked about in the past, that actually controls a lot of the process going forward, so that simply knowing who survived the event isn't sufficient to be able to predict the specific clades that will win. You can answer the question at a coarser level about the kind of ecosystem properties that may come out of it. So it depends on the granularity of what you're looking at.
So Doug, I'm going to ask the last question for the morning for our break, which is just, you didn't mention something that the literature has discussed extensively, which is a distinction between the Permo-Triassic extinction and others. In the most of mass extinctions, the recovery pretty much starts right away. There is this 4 million year period in the early Triassic where things really don't seem to come back.
They didn't. Actually, as people are looking more closely at the early Triassic, it turns out that in particular areas, Oman, some areas in South China, the recovery, parts of the recovery with certain taxa actually begins within a million years. The problem is that there's this incredible volatility for 4 or 5 million years that, although the clades, you know, even ichthyosaurs, are diversifying, and ammonites are diversifying, conodonts are diversifying, the ecosystems are incredibly unstable, and they get wiped out and knocked back, and then they come back and they get knocked back.
But that is a distinction between this extinction and other mass extinctions. And I wonder, and I can't help but think about, unfortunately, the Venezuela case, but thinking about, you know, the magnitude of the extinction and how stable the ecosystem is for recovery in the aftermath.
The problem with that is that if I talk more about the Ordovician mass extinction, which is the second largest event, or the largest if you count differently, if I gave all of you a late Ordovician assemblage and a early Silurian assemblage, you wouldn't be able to tell them apart. Because, you know, half of everything in the marine realm disappears, and then they come back and they're the same taxid doing the same thing, and they even look the same. Yeah. So the difference between those two events is stark.
Interesting. Okay.